Okay, we had a tornado back in March.
Bummer.
We couldn't have assembly at East Park.
Wah.
The River Center fell out of the sky.
Yay!
I guess it was a God thing. Oh my, everything was perfect. It was grand.
Yes!
Dave was even singing with the band.
Pretty good.
Then the pandemic came along.
Oh no!
It's going on and on and on and ooh, 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 ooh. Now we're meeting virtually and ooh, 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 ooh. I wonder, can you tell me when are we ever getting back together? Are we ever getting back together? I am hoping very soon. My meeting room is not on Zoom. When are we ever getting back together? Sing it, Swifty.
What I wouldn't give to have a smoop.
No masks.
Without the smell of Purell in the group. Don's chicken chili is the bomb.
Yum.
Clayton's crock pot meatballs. Give me some. Love to see and laughter all around.
BS.
Another shot of bullet going down.
Oh, yes.
I'm so tired of being out of touch.
Literally.
Yeah, I miss you all so much.
Ooh, 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 ooh. Game night, more good times. Ooh, 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 ooh. They're just not the same online. When are we ever getting back together? Are we ever getting back together? I just want to see you smile, get a hug and chat a while. When are we ever
getting back together?
Ooh, 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 ooh.
Yeah?
Ooh, 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 ooh. No?
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Maybe so. My mental state is shot.
It's got me doing crazy things.
Here's how bad it's got. We've started praying for vaccines.
My puzzle habit has drained all my CARES Act income.
And so, like, my Twitter finger is wore out.
I've run out of home improvement projects to do.
I crocheted a trampoline out of rubber bands.
Happy hour starts whenever I want it to.
I calculated the average number of farts per week. 37. Please help.
Ever
getting back together? Are we ever getting back together? I need to talk to my friends. My friends talk to me. When are we ever getting back together?
I have meant to do applause, and it's not the same on Zoom. Let's just think about how all of this is so bizarre. It's been a weird 6 months, but you know what? We're here, and I'm so excited that everyone is here. My name is Ashley Hall. I am here to host, and we are all here to come together and learn a little bit more about the world today, just like we do every month. For those of you who might be new, Sunday Assembly is a secular congregation that celebrates life. Our motto is live better, help often, and wonder more. Our vision is a Sunday Assembly in every town, village, and community center, commune that wants one. Sunday Assembly has no doctrine and no set text. We make use of wisdom from all sources. Sunday Assembly has no deity. We don't do the supernatural, but we won't tell you you're wrong if you do. Sunday Assembly is radically inclusive. Everyone is welcome regardless of their beliefs. Sunday Assembly is independent, free from outside promotion or sponsorship. And we have a community mission. We build purpose and provide encouragement. We won't tell you how to live, but we will try to help you to do it as well as you can, because Sunday Assembly is a celebration of the one life we know we have. That's something that I think about a lot, one life we know we have. And today, we're going to be learning about something close to my heart. And for the two people who haven't seen my many, many, many Facebook posts. I'm an autistic person. I'm not a person with autism or differently abled female human. Autistic is a vital part of who I am, how I think, how I make decisions, how I interact with people. Anything you can think of that makes a person, it's pretty much autistic. While this has been the case since I was born, I've not always accepted this. Little by little, my life made sense as I started to give context to all the defining aspects of my life. I have a tendency to hyper-focus on topics, weather, Mystery Science Theater 3000, yo, and dolphin, Pokemon. All of these have gripped my mind at one time or another. I have a hard time managing empathy. Not that I don't have it, but I have too much of it. As you can imagine, my Portland, Oregon friends are on my mind all the time right now. I can't bring myself to believe something that isn't true, and altering reality to fit a narrative is incredibly foreign to me. I don't see any reason to hold back my opinion if asked, and I think in songs, and I use them to organize my thoughts. Not to mention pretty much any word uttered by human lips can give me a song to sing. Anywhere at any time. Whether it's in the store, in, you know, a funeral, anywhere. I would go on, but we would be here all day. And I think I can sense what y'all are thinking. I'm tooting my own horn. This is not a Sunday assembly, not one of my one-woman shows where Ashley just lists off her autistic traits until everyone wants to go away. But the reason I'm speaking about myself is that when it comes to neurodiversity, I can only speak for myself. I can't speak for others. That's what neurodiversity means, after all. But one thing in common that I've seen from a lot of people like me is trauma and feelings of being silenced. Marginalization is inherently traumatic, basically across the board. It's why even seemingly flippant comments can bring out such emotional reactions in many, including myself. We're expected to live our lives to make the neurotypical people, or basically the people who don't have a neurodiversity or seem normal and can adhere to social norms, people comfortable by abiding by social rules that are often arbitrary and pointless, all while calming mechanisms for coping with the increasing stimuli in our lives are out of reach or trained out of us at a young age by the most common form of autism treatment, which AKA was modeled after gay conversion therapy. We're walking a tightrope at all times and living with rejection and the ridicule when we inevitably fail, all while being told that everyone goes through what I go through, not realize how constant and overwhelming the struggle is. This can carry over even to our healthy relationships as we become adults and learn how to navigate the world, and can also bring out serious mental health issues. The neurodiverse can suffer from lower lifespans and staggeringly high unemployment. And this is not helped by the largest nonprofit bearing our name easily being considered a hate group. It's a struggle that's largely invisible, even for people with whose autism is more visible than mine, or who have other forms of neurodiversity, such as dyslexia or other forms of mental illness. Even here in the first place where I felt at home has been a struggle, and there have been many struggles and misunderstandings. But the fact that we're discussing this topic is part of why I'm so hopeful. Autistic voices are more vocal than ever, and we have an opportunity to listen to unique voices and better understand what neurodiversity is and what it means to our society and how it functions. Our speaker will be discussing this today and telling us more about how she's working to improve this understanding. But for now, I wanted to share some words from another voice from another uncommon mind. Please welcome Jen Brown, who will be giving us one of our readings, a poem from a fellow autistic.
Good morning, everybody. Poem is titled On Being Autistic, and it's by internet user Poet from Another Planet.
You can join our group, he says, but only if you look everyone in the eyes.
I freeze. Surely he is aware by now that the words autism spectrum disorder in my chart were not placed there for fun. Surely he is aware by now that the finger twitching, body rocking, gaze avoiding are not for my frivolous pleasure. Surely he is aware by now the absurdity of what he asks. I am autistic. Burning irritation of the eyes and panic aside, staring creepily into another human's eyeballs would render group a waste of time, no possibility to listen. He knows this! It is his prejudice that keeps him rooted to the spot. I can feel the weight of his expectations boring into my forehead. Explaining what it is to ask this of me, I remind him that drawing this line would be excluding me because of my autism. I tell him he would be losing a valuable participant, a deep thinker, a creator, an avid listener. I tell him he would be discriminating, that I am protected by law. Oh no, he budges not, for he does not dislike autistic humans, so long as they act like they are neurotypical, so long as I pretend to be someone I am not. Ashley?
That's a good one, man. And I also like it. It's very straightforward. So I wanted to go through our poll today. As you, many of you saw, we had a poll at the beginning of the countdown. And we wanted to see how many people here knew what neurodiversity was, because it is very much a new term that's going around. Looks like it's about half and half, I'd say. That's about what I expected. Hopefully at the end, it'll be completely full. Oh, there's another one. So it's about three-fifths. So that's pretty good. We're a pretty educated group here, so I'd say that's pretty typical. But at the same time, it is, and hopefully at the end of this, everyone will know what it is. And there's so many things about neurodiversity to learn. Hopefully we'll be able to have some resources at the end of this, and I'll try to mention some. But for now, let's go ahead and get started on learning a bit more about neurodiversity for those who don't know. It is a fascinating subject, and I can't wait to show you our speaker, or for our speaker to speak. This is another perspective as well, and her name is Claire Barnett. She graduated from Vanderbilt University in 2019 and is now the communications coordinator for the Frist Center for Autism and Innovation. After her talk, she will be taking questions from everyone, so please feel free to put them in the Zoom chat. If you have any, I'll be reading them off, and we'll see about getting all of your questions answered so that you can learn as much as you can. But for now, without further ado, let's welcome Ms. Claire Barnett.
Hi, guys. So I can't see y'all, but it's nice to virtually meet you. As mentioned, my name is Claire Barnett, and the topic that I'm going to go over today is how the neurodiversity paradigm changes the way we think about autism. And you can expand this to include several other types of neurodiversity. Autistic adults are the group that have most wholeheartedly embraced this term, but we would include things like dyslexia, dysgraphia, ADHD, and sometimes even some mental health diagnoses, depending on whether they're lifelong or temporary, under the neurodiversity umbrella. So that's something to keep in mind as we go through this. But let me tell you a little bit more about myself if we want to go to... second slide. I'm going to introduce myself, and we will do that after this one. I'm sorry, y'all, I don't have these in front of me. Here's sort of a signpost of where we're going, because I'm the kind of person who likes to know exactly what I'm going to learn. And so this is like narrowed down sort of where we're going today. The primary thing that we want to think about is how culture has perceived autism and other neurological differences. And the truth is that these have always been seen from a deficit-based perspective. And we call this the medical model. But new research and self-advocacy from people who are neurodivergent in some way have shown that it's possible and actually benefits people who are wired differently to take a strengths-based perspective instead. So we're going to talk about this, which we would call the social model or the neurodiversity paradigm. They're sort of interchangeable in this context, and talk about the positive implications of leaving the medical model behind. All right, now I'm going to tell you who I am, because I think that's helpful information as we go through this. My name is Claire Barnett. I graduated from Vandy. I work at the Frist Center for Autism and Innovation. One point I like to make here is that it is endowed by the same family that sponsors the Frist Art Museum, but it is a different center. So be sure if you try to look us up that you do not just type in Frist Center, because you're going to end up looking at some really cool art that has nothing to do with us. I was diagnosed with autism in November of 2017 when I was 19 years old. So I am 22 now. It's been nearly 3 years, which is crazy to think. But the truth about autism is that it's a developmental condition. So since I was born, I've had this difference in the way that I think and process information and experience sensory stimuli. But because I never had difficulty in school, the people around me didn't think it could be autism until I was in college and had the opportunity myself to do some self-exploration and try and figure out what about me was different that made some things more challenging. So let's Actually, before we move on, you see a puppy down here. I didn't just do that because I think my dog is cute. I wanted to introduce you guys to Maeve. Come here, kiddo. This is Maeve. Because Maeve has been in training as my service animal. She's a miniature Aussie doodle. She's sleepy right now. Hi. And some people don't realize that autistic adults can have service animals, but what Maeve does is medication reminders, which is a huge help to me because a part of being on the spectrum is a bit of executive dysfunction, which means that a medicine that's supposed to be taken at 9 a.m. ends up not getting taken until 9 p.m., and that really affects my quality of life. So having her trained to know when to remind me to take my medicine has been a huge help. Yeah, so if anybody has questions at the end about autism service dogs or some of the other tasks they perform or what it's been like to have Maeve, let me know. Yeah, but we can keep moving now. Great. So the first half of this presentation is the basics. And a lot of you said you already have some information about neurodiversity, so this may just be a reminder about things that you already know. But if you're one of the people who said that you don't know about neurodiversity, then you'll get a chance here to fill in all of those background pieces. These are the vocab words that I may use and that you may decide to use going forward. Neurodiversity itself is a noun, and it's just the concept, the idea, that there are certain neurological differences which confer both challenges and gifts. So that's going to be different from something like an anxiety disorder, for example, because certain types of mental illness, which we would differentiate from neurological condition, only confer challenges. And it may be that you cope really well with it or that you are able to do incredible things despite dealing with that challenge, but it doesn't give you any sort of way of thinking that's an advantage. It's really just something that you want to treat and live your life the best you can while you're also dealing with that mental health challenge. And some areas that fall into mental health have a little bit of an overlap because they're lifelong conditions or for large swaths of life. One example would be bipolar, because we see people with bipolar who go between depressive states and states of high energy and creativity. So it's a little bit of a blurry line there between mental illness and neurodiversity, but the idea is really, does it have some sort of gift or strength or ability that kind of comes with that condition as well? Neurodivergent is an adjective we'd use to describe a person whose brain is neurologically atypical. Honestly, this is just a bit of a grammatical pet peeve of mine when people describe a person singular as neurodiverse. One person can't be diverse, but they can be divergent. That's how you know my mom was an English teacher. Anyway, so neurodivergent is a word that I might use or that you might use going forward to describe a person you've met who has a condition that falls under neurodiversity. And then finally, neurotypical, interestingly, can be an adjective or a noun. So it would be describing a person who's developing typically, or it could be the person themselves, like that person is a neurotypical. Don't ask me why we use that one in both parts of speech. It just is. So, yeah, those are good words to know going forward. On our next slide, we've got a little bit more information about what conditions are included in neurodiversity. And so I touched on this some, but the three big ones that you're going to hear about a lot, and these individuals are most likely to say that they want to be viewed through the neurodiversity perspective, are going to be ADHD, and almost everybody knows somebody with ADHD. I mean, there's probably somebody in our audience who has that diagnosis. This condition is marked by persistent inattention, hyperactivity, and sometimes impulsivity, but it is also often marked by the ability to hyperfocus, high innovation and energy, and strong empathy. So we're seeing there, because of the way that an ADHD person is wired differently, they've got both some very real challenges and some very real strengths that we see more often in that population. Another example is dyslexia. The DSM would say it's a condition that causes one to have difficulty reading or interpreting words, letters, or symbols. But we've also seen that a ton of people with dyslexia also have really good visual thinking abilities and high creativity. And I've seen several articles in big newspapers in the last several years about CEOs that have ADHD or that have dyslexia, and they credit it for the way that they were able to think outside the box and solve problems in a way that other people, like it hadn't occurred to them to do that. And then the last condition, which I'm going to zero in on a little bit here because that's the one I have personal experience with, is autism. And autism is defined by difficulty with social communication and restricted or repetitive thoughts and behaviors. And I will point out that that second part of the diagnosis, the restricted or repetitive thoughts and behaviors, can look really different depending on how intense the autism symptoms are for that person. For someone who is level 3, or in other words, has really high support needs, that may mean that, you know, there's a complete sensory meltdown if something new is introduced to the routine. But for me, that might mean that because I do live independently and control my own day, that I make a choice to do everything in my routine the exact same way every single day, because that's something that helps me sort of stay calm and on purpose and not increasing that anxiety. So that piece can look really different depending on which autistic person you're talking to. And that's where a lot of people don't understand the spectrum, because they have met someone who has more intense support needs and don't understand how that person could have the same diagnosis as somebody who would have previously been called Asperger's. But anyway, the gifts that can come with autism are ability to recognize patterns and exceptional memory for detail and hyperfocus, among others. And I would say that I've seen these in those. Okay. I'm afraid I may have frozen for a second. Maybe it was just on my screen. But just in case I did, I was just saying that I have seen some of these strengths in my own life, and I would attribute some of my success to having those strengths, and they're definitely connected to being autistic. All right, and then the final thing on this slide is just the idea that there can be more conditions included, but then there's a line between, like, does this condition have strengths that are sort of built in or not? So let's keep going. Awesome. So what exactly is autism? We'll go through this quickly because I already touched on some of it in the last slide. But diagnosis requires these two criteria. The first being difficulty with social communication and interaction, which has definitely been true in my life. And that was one of the things that motivated me to get a diagnosis, because I got to college in particular and had no clue how people were supposed to make friends. It seemed like they all had some manual I didn't have. The next piece is strong affinity for routine, structure, and sameness. You know, this might be the person who is a very hyper-logical thinker, needs there to be a schedule every single day, wants to do things in a way that's consistent and reliable. And anybody can have sort of one or two of those traits, but having your whole life affected by that affinity for, or that need for, really, routine and structure is one thing that gets it over into the clinical side of being autism spectrum and not just a trait that is sort of resembling an autistic trait. Other common traits that are not a part of the diagnosis criteria are low or no eye contact. It feels really intense and intimate, and so it's a lot easier to think and communicate when you don't have to look in somebody's eyes. We see a lot of sensory hypersensitivity, so stimuli in the world are just translated as being really overwhelming by that person's body. And can even be painful if too much is happening. We also see very literal, straightforward use of language. And we see a lot of co-occurring mental health diagnoses like anxiety, and especially social anxiety, because you're seeing people that have trouble with social communication, but still need human interaction because they're human themselves. Okay, so let's keep going to our next slide. I think this is something people don't realize, that our best estimates are that about 2% of people are on the autism spectrum, and that is 1 in 50. So, I mean, you think about the number of people you know. Chances are you know several people on the spectrum, whether they know they have that diagnosis or not. So I would keep in mind as you meet people every day that there is a good chance that they either have some neurodivergent condition, because we estimate that about 15% of the population, like 15%, have one of those neurodivergent conditions. But in particular, you are meeting people in your life and will continue to meet them throughout your life who are on the spectrum. And you may want to know to communicate with those people differently or to give them some grace when they don't do whatever social thing you expected them to do. Okay, so if we keep on moving to slide 14, this is a really popular quote in the neurodiversity world, and it's that if you know one person with autism, you know one person with autism. And we've kind of taken the old quote that, you know, if you know one person who's a farmer, you know all the farmers, and turn that around. Nothing special about farmers there. I just thought of that because that's what my dad does. And the truth is that when it comes to neurodiversity, these conditions present really differently in everybody. I mean, think about how broad something like inattention or difficulty with social communication is, and the way that all the other factors in a person's life, like other parts of their personality or the way they're raised or the culture they're raised in, all of that feeds into how that condition presents. So don't ever assume that because you've met one person with one of these conditions, like you get all everybody who has ADHD or autism or dyslexia or OCD, because you don't. And that's why, just like with any human, it's incredibly important to get to know every individual as an individual first. All right, let's keep going. So here's the part, and we're going to go through this a little more quickly because now you guys understand the background of autism and neurodiversity. But here's the part where I want to challenge you to just really analyze how you think about these conditions. And it's where we're going to look at the medical versus social models. So first, let's go to the medical model. So this is diagnosis-centric. It's focusing entirely on the diagnostic manual and the deficits listed in that manual, and it's going to assume that any condition diagnosed is a negative, undesirable part of who that person is. That, you know, chances are they want to hide it. In fact, that's one of the reasons that the law doesn't require that people with disabilities disclose what their disability is. They're only required to tell, for example, an employer that they need an accommodation and that they have a disability. It's because the medical model is set up to assume that that's something you're embarrassed about. And so you can imagine that knowing, particularly when young children are diagnosed, they kind of grow up thinking this is a part of them they're supposed to be ashamed of. Now, if we go on and look at the way that the social model is different, we're going to see that it's really focused on the individual. So kind of like I described a moment ago, we're looking at the way that that person's wired differently, but we're also looking at who they are and how do they learn, and how can we help them be more successful in life without telling them they have to change who they are? And this model particularly focuses on the person's strengths without dismissing the challenges. So when you hear strengths focused, you may think, well, then how do people get accommodations for the things they have trouble with? Because there are significant elements of challenge or disability in all of these conditions. Well, the thing is that you have to be able to hold both of those things in your mind at the same time. You need to be able to understand or accommodate somebody with this disability while also saying that you're not going to view them from a primarily disability-focused place, that instead you're going to look at what their abilities and strengths are. And so in the social model, we're assuming that that condition is a valuable part of the person's identity and that you can't separate it out from who they are. And so it's not the entirety of their identity, but it does affect every part of it. And so then that takes us into the neurodiversity paradigm, which is really just what we call the social model as it's applied to neurodiversity, because there are a lot of different sort of movements in the world where you could say, oh, there's a medical model of this condition and there's a social model. But with neurodiversity specifically, we want to say that rather than people with developmental neurological conditions being broken, they embody a dimension of diversity. And that seems simple, but in real life, it can be really difficult to get past the built-in stigmas or stereotypes that you've seen all around you in this world. And I would say that this movement is really similar to Deaf Pride, where a lot of people who are deaf or hard of hearing have resisted cochlear implants and are really proud of deaf culture, dwarfism or little people pride. And we've seen, too, where people in that community have said, like, we don't want growth hormones that make us just like everyone else. We think the way we are is just fine. And even the LGBT pride movement, where folks have said, like, no, you actually don't need to change us or make us more like you or make us fit a mold that would maybe make life easier. Because that's something we hear with a lot of autistic children's parents is they just want their kids to have an easier life. So that's why they put them through ABA therapy or one of these other therapies that are really built to, like, train them that their instincts are wrong and they should have neurotypical instincts or reactions instead. So, yeah, I can't remember what I put after this slide, to be real honest. So, oh, yeah, I do remember this now. Okay, what strengths do neurodivergent people have? We're not going to go through these individually, but in case you've been hearing this and just thinking, you know, what talents might you see in this population, here are a few examples. And not everybody who's neurodivergent has all of these gifts. But it's important to recognize that when they do have these, a lot of times they're a result of the way that that person is wired differently. And that is absolutely true for me, because the same part of me that needs structure and routine in my day is also really good at picking up on small details and analyzing logically. So you can't separate those things out. And it's important for me to be able to live my life in a productive, successful way without those sort of needs for routine getting in the way of that. But also, if I didn't have these strengths, I wouldn't have been successful in school the way I was, and I wouldn't have gotten the job I have now. So I'm pretty sure we also have a slide in here just showing, the center where I work. So in case you want to Google it, this is what that homepage will look like, and you can find out tons more information about the Center for Autism and Innovation. We're the only center in the world researching autism and employment, so adults on the spectrum having meaningful opportunities. And if you're curious about this and want to keep up with us, I would encourage you to follow us on Instagram, because that is where we post all of our news updates. They're also on the website, but we don't currently have a system set up for like sending out an email blast when a news post goes out. So Instagram would be the best way to keep up with us. All right. So I believe that that is the conclusion of my presentation, and we're going to shift into a Q&A. If you have questions about my personal experience getting diagnosed, or my service animal, or my job at the Frist Center, or any of the information I shared, I'm happy to answer anything.
Well, we do have one question from, I believe, Franco's okay with me saying his name. I'm just going to assume, since Jason included it, but any favorite neurodivergent musicians, especially when did you realize they were neurodivergent? And one example he gave was David Byrne, the leader of the Talking Heads.
Wow, you have got the complete wrong person to talk about pop culture. In part because, like a lot of autistic people, I have some face blindness. So I can't really differentiate individuals very well. I have a lot of trouble with actors and actresses, and even like watching TV shows, trying to figure out which character's which from moment to moment. The only neurodivergent musician that I am aware of is a music professor at Vanderbilt named Dr. Emmeline Bingham, who is a fantastic musician and does research on the way that music can be a really useful outlet and potential career path for autistic adults. So I'm absolutely certain that there are dozens, if not hundreds, of autistic musicians out there that are like people you've heard of. Because I think there's a high affinity for things that involve non-language-based communication, and music is one of those.
Well, I mean, as I said before, music is definitely a way I organize my thoughts, so that's definitely the truth. Although it usually comes out very irritating, but what can I do? So we just got another, we actually have someone from Brazil who's watching us today in Zoom. So we're international. Woo. His question is, how can we take advantage from our personalities? I think that what that means is, and if you're out there, feel free to clarify, but asked about taking advantages from our personalities, I guess recognizing our strengths, I would imagine, from our personalities.
Yeah. So obviously there's something happening there in translation, perhaps, that's missed.
Yeah.
But if it is what you suggest, I think finding out if you have a neurodivergent condition can be really big for knowing who you are and what strengths you have and what challenges that you have are actually connected to a disability. So just in the context of neurodiversity, I would say that I have been better able to address the things I have trouble with and make use of the things I'm good at because I pursued that diagnosis. So not everyone is neurodivergent, but if you have any questions about whether or not you are, I would highly encourage you to pursue a diagnosis, whether it's something that you share with everybody once you have it or something that you never tell anybody but you just know about yourself. And even if you're not neurodivergent, I think we can agree that it's best to treat humanity from a strengths-based perspective. So, you know, anybody out there, like, focusing on what you can do instead of what you can't is always going to have a better result.
Yeah, because Renato clarified, he said that he likes establishing patterns, but a lot of people interpret this as inflexibility. So understand that for sure. So yeah. That can definitely be a struggle, but using that as a strength can be, from my perspective, and I apologize for taking over, but
no, go ahead.
It can be a very lifelong work to try and learn how to turn that into a strength, because no matter what you do, there's going to be someone who doesn't like the way you do it. But I always say seeing that as a strength and just kind of doing the mental work, the power of positive thinking sometimes works. So seeing that as a strength can often be good.
We always encourage people who come to the Frist Center to have a one-on-one with like a boss or a coworker who's having difficulty with something, and try to explain your thought process, but also try to reframe it if possible. So if you're able to say like, I know this thing can be, bothersome to the team at these times, but this is why I think that way. And here are situations where I think it could be positive. Maybe help them see that your tendency to do things like find patterns doesn't have to just be something that's bothersome.
Mm-hmm. Good. Excellent. So here's the next question. What advice, if any, would you give someone who thinks they might be on the spectrum?
Okay, so I think a lot of that depends on where you are in life. If you're under, 20 and you have family around you that can go with you to a diagnostician, a clinical psychologist, a psychiatrist, I would strongly encourage you to do that while they still have memories of your childhood, because that's something that really helps a clinician be able to say, yes, this has been here since you were 1 year old, versus no, these are symptoms of something else that's happened more recently. So if you're at any age that you've still got a parent, a guardian, a close family member who remembers you before you remember you, definitely I would jump on that and go on and see if you can get their help, sort of talking to a doctor and feeling out if that could be you. If you're past that stage in life, I would still encourage you to pursue it. Again, for the reason that it's just really useful self-exploration. And everyone I've ever met who has gotten an autism diagnosis specifically has said that what they felt was relief to find out that they weren't the only one who thought like they did and felt like they did. And some of those people have gone on to say, I know for me, and now I don't want to talk about it anymore. And others have said, I'm going to be a self-advocate and everybody's going to hear about it. I think you know which camp I fell into because I'm here talking to you guys today. But regardless of whether you have those crucial people who knew you when you were really young, I think it's still worth pursuing personally. And I would start by researching people who have some experience with adult autism. I'm going to assume whoever's asked this question has reached, 16, 17, old enough that they chose to join Sunday Assembly and are listening today. Because it's really important to have somebody who has experience with adults on the spectrum. A lot of clinicians know about children on the spectrum and have no clue what that turns into once that person is 25 or 30. So find a doctor who actually knows something about it instead of just going to anybody, and then look into it would be my advice.
So what are some books that we can read that will help us understand and relate to neurodivergent people, or maybe podcasts for people who are auditory learners?
Absolutely. So the book question is fantastic because, where did we put it? On our website, we have got a sheet that you can download or just look at on the website called the Neurodiversity Reading List. And on the Frist Center website, it's under Tools and Resources. And we've got books on here related to autism, ADHD, dyslexia, intellectual disability, because that's commonly considered a part of neurodiversity, and then sort of other. So some of my favorites are Thinking in Pictures by Temple Grandin. So Temple Grandin has had a completely unique experience of autism because every experience is different, but I think she does a good job of explaining what it's like to feel different, but to still want to be a part of the world and still want to contribute to it. I also have heard fantastic things about Neurotribes. And my mother read it when I got diagnosed and said that it really helped her understand what was happening. I have not picked it up yet because I'll warn you, it's the size of a Bible. So if the reading was what scares you away from Christianity, then you won't want Neurotribes. Sorry, I don't know if that's funny or not. But anyway, there are several other examples on this list, though. So I would encourage you to check that out if you want to read. As far as podcasts, there have been several autistic adults who created their own small podcasts. But the best examples of learning about neurodiversity are usually one-offs on those podcasts that are like, you want to learn about psychology or you want to learn about the workplace. And so if you would like some specific recommendations, you can email me and I could share those episodes that I know of.
Okay, so we have a couple more questions. Second to last is from Aubrey. Are there any local mentors or pet therapy programs tailored to support autistic children here in Nashville?
Oh, that's an excellent question. So the organization I know of that supports families the most is going to be Triad. And so that's Vanderbilt's other autism research center. And they've been around for far longer than we have because the services they provide are the ones that you're generally more familiar with. They're the ones geared towards diagnosing young children and helping families figure out how to advocate for those children and helping those children find the resources they need to develop both socially and emotionally, physically. And so Triad is through Vanderbilt's Kennedy Center, and I believe it stands for Treatment and Research Institute for Autism Spectrum Disorders. Don't ask me what happened to the S in that acronym. It just didn't sound good, I guess. So Triad is what it's called. And the people over there are remarkable in terms of working individually with families and connecting them to resources and information. There's also Autism Tennessee. And we love Autism Tennessee. They do fantastic work. They're struggling a little bit at the moment because their facilities were hit by the tornado, same as you guys. But they have several different resource groups and parent support groups, and they actually have an adult support group. So if you know, your child turns into an adult one day, they can join that group. I don't know a ton about resources for kids in this area specifically because I was diagnosed at 19. But the last place I would recommend would be Curry Ingram Academy, because they even have some like after school and summer programs, even if your child doesn't attend that school. But Curry Ingram is geared towards students with developmental differences and learning disabilities. So I have a cousin who goes there who has pretty severe ADHD, but a lot of their students are on the spectrum. And before my cousin Sam went to Curry Ingram, he first did a summer camp with them and absolutely loved it. He was finally able to learn in a way that he felt like suited him.
Awesome. Sorry. We got another question and I just wanted to make sure we could squeeze it in, and we can. So that's good because it's a good question. But first off, how is there a good way to approach one's therapist about the topic of neurodiversity, and specifically if you don't know if they're open to it or open to the social model as opposed to the medical model?
I have seen so many people approach a therapist, a psychologist, with this question and receive a non-supportive or kind of ignorant response. So if you already have a therapist and you want to ask them about this, you know, the first thing I would say is brace yourself for them not having the knowledge you would hope they had. And we want that to change. In 2-3 decades, I want to see that every person who is a therapist for adults knows as much about autism as in adults as they do about depression in adults. But that is not the reality right now. So be prepared for them to, you know, hopefully just be a little bit clueless about it, but possibly even be resistant to that idea. But that's not necessarily what's going to happen. So it's definitely worth bringing up. And if you find that this individual has almost no knowledge about that, or seems to think that you couldn't be autistic, and they list off a bunch of reasons and doesn't actually hear you out about why you think that could be you, that might be a hint that this should be something that's taken up with a different doctor, which is not to say you would have to abandon the therapist you know and love, but just that this particular discussion might need to be had with someone else. Yeah,
you don't know until you try, but with therapists, it's hard.
Well, and on occasion, a therapist won't have knowledge, but will be open to learning. I've heard a few times that someone said, you know, my doctor didn't know anything about autism in adults, but when I brought it up, they did a lot of research, and they've been working with me using the skills they learned at school, and it's gone great. So I'm not going to say that them not having that knowledge is necessarily like, oh man, we better part ways. Because sometimes that turns out well, but I have also heard of it not turning out well at all. And so I think that's something you should be prepared for.
Okay, so this is the last question. It's from Lori. Where would someone like me, age 61, go to get a diagnosis here in Nashville?
Well, I can tell you the name of the center where I go, where I still see my doctor. It's Green Hills Family Psych. And I know the doctor that I see there is familiar with adult autism because she gave me my diagnosis and we still meet on a pretty regular basis. She just got back off maternity leave. So haven't seen her in about 2 months, but I'm eager to meet with her again starting in about 2 weeks. So I don't know if it's just Dr. Harrington at that facility who has knowledge of adult autism or if the other doctors do too, but I at least know that they are experienced and open-minded and would work with Dr. Harrington to learn more if you happen to get an appointment with a different doctor at that facility. So that is the only place here in Nashville I can specifically recommend that you look. Because I know when I went to Dr. Harrington, she didn't say, well, you know, you made it to be too old. If you'd had autism, it would have shown up before now. And that's the kind of thing that a lot of times you'll hear a doctor say. You need someone who's willing to say, oh, yeah, if you have good coping skills and if it's something that you never struggled with, you know, in this way or this stereotypical way, then this could have totally been overlooked till you're 61. And we know of particularly lots of women who are diagnosed really late in life because doctors think this is a little boy's disorder.
Yeah, definitely. And I do know Athena Consulting can test for autism. They do psychological testing as well. So that's where I got psychological testing. So, and I know those are only two places, but if anyone else knows anything, feel free to send it in the Zoom chat.
Oh, I tell you what, actually, you might contact Autism Tennessee if those first two leads don't pan out, because Autism Tennessee does have a longer list of people with experience in different areas of autism. They have a lot of connections around the Tennessee and especially Middle Tennessee area.
All right. Well, that's the last question. That was amazing. That was a great Q&A. Everyone sent such amazing questions. I'm really happy about that. It looks like we're going to be getting some people some changed lives. I'm really excited about that. But next thing we're going to be doing is our moment of mindfulness. It's a moment we do every week, or every month rather, where we just sort of sit and reflect in silence. What I usually do is I just think about how I can apply this to my life. But whatever you would like to do and use this time for, do whatever you need to do. And right after that, we'll have a song from Stephen and Georgia.
In a time full of war, be peace. In a time full of doubt, just believe. Yeah, there ain't that much difference between you and me. In a time full of war, be peace. In a world full of hate, be a light. When you do somebody wrong, make it right. No, don't hide in the dark, you were born to shine. In a world full of hate, be a light. La 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 la.
In a place that needs change, make a difference. In a time full of noise, just listen.
Cause life is but a breeze, better live it. In a place that needs a change, make a difference. In a world full of hate, be a light. When you do somebody wrong, make it right. Oh, don't hide in the dark, you were born to shine. In a world full of hate be a light. La 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 la. In a race that you can't win, slow it down.
Yeah, you only get one go round.
'Cause the finish line is 6 feet in the ground.
In a race you can't win, just slow it down.
In a world full of hate, be a light. When you do somebody wrong, make it right. Oh, don't hide in the dark, you were born to shine. In a world full of hate, be a light. It's hard to live in color when you just see black and white. In a world full of hate, be a light.
I love that song. So, coming up next is one of my favorite segments, not gonna lie. It's called Trying My Best. And those of us who grew up in church know what testimonies are, but this is one of those things where I feel like is one of the most fantastic things we could possibly do in a community like this, which is share our struggles and how we got through it and how we lived through it and get to know each other's what each other has gone through. And the person in the hot seat today is JoJo Lorenzen. And so please welcome her to the virtual stage.
Hot seat is about right. Okay. All right. So for me, being neurodivergent has to do with being bipolar. So I'm just going to put that in the limelight right off the bat. Here we go. I am not my illness. That has been my mantra for 10 years now. In 2010, I was diagnosed with bipolar. And that was the first thought that came to my mind were, it has a name. And I am not my illness. I have lived and struggled these past 10 years trying to stay true to that mantra. I went from job to job, unable to stay mentally stable long enough to hold one for very long. Relationships were a joke. I had maybe 2 serious ones in all that time. Life was harder than it seemed it should be. It felt like I was fighting just to stay afloat when everyone around me was thriving. I could never figure out what was going on, and it never could get going right. All I could do was just make it one day at a time, constantly repeating to myself, I am not my illness. Whenever I had a break, a bad day, or any number of times I felt out of control, I am not my illness, I would say. Then recently, I learned of neurodiversity. Now something new has come to mind. What if my illness isn't an illness? What if there's nothing wrong with me? What if I'm just different? Complicated, sure, but just different. That changes things. Suddenly, there's this new view of being able to see what everyone else was telling me is broken, is wrong, is ill, isn't. It's something that can be worked with, and I can even see the strange positives that it has given me. I'm compassionate, loving, and loyal. Some may even say to a fault. But I'm more creative now than I've ever been in my life. I use that as a way to ease the chaos of my mind. It focuses me. I find so many ideas and I love to learn. I can fly from one topic to another and swallow up as much as there is to learn. I was actually recently playing Halo 4 with my brother and got very upset after more than one upheaval of failing to learn to play a game that he, at a level that he plays at. I then had to have a conversation with him, doing my best to explain to him how my learning curve is drastically different than that of a neurotypical person like himself. What he sees as just another lost game, I see as a failure of grasping a game in a series I've known since I was a teen. I've learned the games by slow calculating steps, not his way of just throwing into the frantic melee. So this game I now have worked out with him to take it slow and steady, to learn at my pace, and still play with him together. Knowing all this now about neurodiversity, I know that even going on this new path doesn't mean dropping off my meds and going off the deep end. That part still has to go on. It keeps me stable. But if I change my perspective to this new angle, it may allow me to accept this part of myself that I've been fighting for so long. And maybe that's where I'll find the peace I've never had the ability to have. And maybe trying my best to turn "I am not my illness" into "I am bipolar" and not being ashamed of it. That's me.
I love it. Now, JoJo's a good friend of mine, so I'm very happy that she was able to share her story, because it's a good one. She's awesome. So now time for the fun part, y'all. Announcements. Yay! Everyone loves announcements. Okay. So we at Sunday Assembly Nashville are completely nonprofit. We run off donations, and we are going to be looking at a poll right now. I thought announcements were first. Sorry about that, y'all. So, but basically we are going to be running a poll about which charity to give to today. All three involve neurodiversity. The Autism Self-Advocacy Network is more national. Noticeability is related to dyslexia, and it is based in Chattanooga. And Autism Tennessee is what Claire had mentioned before. Now, they have been dealing with the tornado and have been dealing with their facilities being damaged. So that is one that think will be a little bit of an, they'll give them a little bit of an advantage, and it looks like it already has. So, but honestly, donating to any of these charities will be fantastic. They're all autistic approved and neurodivergent approved. So, and I use the term neurodiverse too in a singular, so I got to stop doing that. But yeah, it's definitely going to be money well spent wherever it goes. But it looks like Autism Tennessee is winning right now, but we'll be able to vote until well after assembly. So if you haven't decided yet, feel free to make the decision whenever you need to. All right, so as for announcements today, I believe we can go to the first one. So what I'm going to be sharing with you today is we are going to be having our board elections very soon, next month, in fact. That is very important because our board are the ones who make the major decisions about Sunday Assembly and how it is run. So if you would like to help with that, that'd be fantastic. We're holding our elections this year via Zoom due to COVID. All applications and votes will be received electronically. Elected board members will be required to serve a 2-year term, attend all board meetings, and actively participate in helping Sunday Assembly reach its goals. There are 2 board member seats open during this election. Kay Cho will be taking applications after the September Assembly, and the voting procedures will be announced during October Assembly. And finally, all votes will be tallied up, and the new board members will be announced during November Assembly. So please contact Kay Cho. His email address is K-U-N as in Nancy, H-E-E-C-H-O 89@gmail.com if you would like to apply or have any questions. Or you can just reach out to him in the Secret Secret Sunday Assembly group on Facebook. There we go. Got it. Okay, it's like a tongue twister. All right, so as I mentioned before, we are completely nonprofit and we are volunteer-led, and we are 100% dependent on donations. So as Lori always says, where 2 or more are gathered, there are expenses. Yay. So even though we don't have a particular, we aren't meeting physically right now, we do still have expenses. So if you would like to become a sustaining member, you can just set it and forget it with recurring monthly donations, or you can also make a one-time donation on PayPal. There are ways to do that online. And unfortunately, that's the only way to do it right now. We used to pass around a hat, but that's not happening right now. So if you would like to donate, that would be fantastic, and make it every month. It's been a really, really big help. And if you would like to get involved as a volunteer, that would be fantastic as well. These are the folks who run each particular section of volunteering production, which is helping with everything involved in production. That's Jason. Music is Stephen Phelps, who you saw singing earlier today. Live Better is Brenda Quinn. They are the ones who help with our projects. And Help Often is Kate Turner. They also do the volunteer projects and what in normal times, rather, we do try to do a volunteer project every month. And hopefully that'll be starting again soon. But right now we're also using that for charities. So if you would like to be part of that. And Wondermore, which is the committee that meets every month to determine what Sunday Assembly is going to look like and what our topics are going to be. If you you can talk to Nicole or Teresa in our group. So those are people who will be able to help you out with that. They meet once a month, so it shouldn't be too big a deal. You can also join us on social media. We do have a regular Sunday Assembly Nashville group and a secret one. So if you don't want to put it out there that you're part of our group, or you don't, that's perfectly fine. You can just join the secret group and request to join. Also follow us on Twitter at Nash Sunday Assembly or Nash Sun Assembly. .com? Wow. Anyway, Sunday Assembly Nashville is also on Instagram. So please follow us. You can also find us on YouTube, where all of our old assemblies are. So if you missed one or would like to think about the topic or would like to watch this one again, feel free to do so. That would be fantastic. I do it all the time. So, and I believe it is now time for me to close. And there has been a lot talked about today, and it's made me so incredibly encouraged. And one of the reasons why I really did want an assembly like this is, first of all, because there are a lot of neurodivergent people in our community that I'd like to talk about themselves more and discuss more about their own neurodiversity. But also, and neurodiverse people do tend to be, or neurodivergent people do tend to be secular and gender nonconforming, and there's not a lot of communities for them here in Nashville or in the South in general. So finding our community can meet a very good need for that, because we are secular. We don't need any doctrines, and we don't require like vague things to be a part of it. And as someone who has found a home in this community, there's a lot of diverse people who can make very good friends with them. I made some of my best friends here, and we do a great job based on my experience, but we should never ever be satisfied with our current state. We should be seeking to constantly improve and constantly change, because once we think we've made it, we haven't made it. I have always said during the election, someone who thinks they've made it is probably not someone I want to be around. But anyway, a good way to use what you've heard today is in everyday life is to think about how you feel when excluded, or when you don't understand what's going on in a conversation, or when you go to another country and don't know the customs. That's a way you can help empathize. That's a neurodiverse person's life all the time. And it can help with empathy if someone comes to you overwhelmed or distressed state. Or if you are neurodiverse, one thing that helps me with empathy is to think about my isolation and how it relates to other marginalizations like LGBT. That's one thing that's been very helpful to me since grad school, and it's been great. And it's been one way I've been able to see sort of into that world. I've also encouraged everyone to look at the social norms that are in place in various groups you're in, work groups, friend groups, fan groups, see which of them might have a point and which don't. Think about even the banal things that might be exclusionary. And if you can't think of any, ask a particularly blunt neurodiverse friends to point them out when you see them. I can't promise all of us will be comfortable sharing, considering how used to rejection and dismissal, or maybe just we don't see anything wrong personally, but it might be wrong for someone else. So get a variety of opinions on it. And but also join autism or dyslexia or bipolar groups on Facebook or Discord or Reddit. One on Facebook that I particularly recommend is Unashamed Voices of Autism, and also the resources that Claire shared, the reading list or the podcast list. I share from Unashamed Voices of Autism a lot, and they have a lot of good information in meme form, as well as comments you can hear from various voices about who struggles, who doesn't. But the one thing I wanted to leave you here is that neurodiversity is not a mystery. The answers are out there and way more straightforward than you might think. All you have to do is show unconditional positive regard and ask. There you go. So now what we're going to be doing is going...
It's too late.
Going to our friend Stephen Phelps with probably one of my favorite songs and one of my favorites.
One, two, one, two, three, four.
I believe in good. Oh, I believe in good. I believe in being good and doing good. Just for goodness sake, good makes the whole world better. Good is great, and I believe in harmony. Respect for all humanity. I believe that we will find the only truth we need, living this one life by this one creed. I believe in good. I believe in good. I believe in good. Oh, I believe in good. I believe in being good and doing good. Just for goodness sake, good makes the whole world better. Good is great, and I believe in harmony. Respect for all humanity. I believe that we will find the only truth we need, living this one life by this one.